It's good to have two sticks, isn't it?
Yes!
It's good to, you guys are okay?
Yes!
Well, good morning to you.
Good morning.
It's been a great day of worship so far. We're going to keep it going. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I do have one thing to wrap before I get going. I messed it up. Brown was right. The congregational Sunday, congregational midweek is on the 19th, which is not this Wednesday, it's the following Wednesday. What I want to do this midweek is something a little different, though. If you can bear with me. We've been talking about the love story series for a while now. I really want to encourage you by the midweek to find somebody that you can sit down and study with and share that with. And maybe two or three of you, find someone to study with on Wednesday, you know. And if you can't find anybody, maybe take a group and go share. You can share your faith somewhere. But to really use midweek as an opportunity for 2, 3, 4 of us to go and share what we know, what we're learning with somebody else. Does that sound good to you?
Yeah.
That's like a fun midweek to me.
Yeah.
Amen. Why don't we pray and keep on going? Heavenly Father God, thank you so much for your love for us. Thank you for your encouragement, your grace, and your spirit, and your power. We pray right now that we can clear our minds. And clear our hearts and fix our hearts and minds on you.
Right.
We know you've got something to say to us this morning, and you've already been speaking to us. And I pray that we open wide to receive it and really fight all the distractions that Satan's trying to clutter us with. God, move me out the way. Move my flesh out the way and speak to us through your spirit, through your word. And I pray that we can receive it and really become the men and women you want us to be. We pray all this in your name, your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, that's me, Frank Davis, up there somewhere. This is HavenRock. We've been doing a series. We started the series last week. We're doing the love story series now in the sermons. So we had part one last week. We got part two this week. And the name of part two is a love letter. So that should be just locked in now, the love letters. We got that going for us. And so I'll explain a little bit more what that means in a second. Right now we got a short video, and we'll go from there.
Step on that gas pedal, and I'll come step on your feet. The light's green, go! Where'd you learn to drive, Helen Keller?
Here I am to worship.
Really? Use the crosswalk. I will hit a pedestrian. I will hit a pedestrian.
Every move I make, I'm making you.
Oh, really? You in a big hurry? You drive a Prius. Go save the planet.
The splendor.
Nice haircut, loser.
Oh, that is it.
You can thank Kenny for that video. She finds the funny ones. You know, sometimes there's a disconnect between what we know Christianity is supposed to be in households. You know, I would say that Christianity is broken because a lot of what we see out here going by the way of Christianity is not what we see in the Bible. But the truth is, forget about what is broken around the world. Sometimes it's broken in us. It's broken in us. And we got this great playlist, right? But we're not living the playlist. So the love letter, what's that about? You know, I really believe that this is about, all of this is about having a relationship with God rather than just practicing religion. And learning to really live out the relationship. And the love letter, that part of it, if we get it, if we connect with it, it changes everything. But anytime there's a disconnect, we can't function because the relationship is not functioning. Now, what does all that mean? Next slide. Very well-known passage. Just as for God so loved the world, that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. That's John 3:16. Very well-known passage. Let's read the next passage as well. Acts 2:36-37. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this, God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Okay, I grew up going to church. I didn't know many scriptures. Because I went to church, I didn't need my Bible. There's a difference, right? But the one scripture I know I knew was John 3:16. Right? That God so loved the world. I could quote that one. If I could quote anything in my life, I could quote that one passage, right? I could find that passage in the Bible. And I believed it. But I believed it but it didn't have an impact in my life. It was just kind of like background information, like, you know, your car's parked outside. Yeah, and Jesus died for the world. It wasn't this driving force of this thing that I thought about, or I just kind of felt like that happened. Right? That's me. And then you read Acts 2. And this crowd of people heard for the first time that they crucified Jesus. Now understand, they had just come to Jerusalem for a feast. They were in town when Jesus died. But they understood, like we come to understand, that they were responsible for Christ's death in the same way that we are. Yeah. And that the Messiah, the Christ, died on the cross. It says it cut them to the heart. And they were like, look, what do we have to do to make this right? And when you go on and read the passage, everything about them changed. Based on that one sermon. That was toward the end of the sermon. But he talked about Jesus and the cross and what that meant. And it changed their lives. Now here's the thing. This is something they got that I didn't get. And I tell you the difference between religion and relationship, between being a disciple and just going to church, between heaven and hell. Oftentimes, is the 6 inches between your brain and your heart. It's getting the cross and its message from head knowledge to heart knowledge. And I think there's something that we miss sometimes, or sometimes we've got and we forget, that stops that from happening. Next slide. See, there's more to the story. There's more to the story. If you go on to the next slide, the reality is this whole thing about the cross is not just information, it's a love story. It's a love letter written to us. And if we can grasp the love letter, we're not going to be lacking in motivation. You know, sometimes we present, we present it as, this is what you got to do to follow Jesus. You know, man, you got to pray, you got to read your Bible, you got to love people, you got to seek and save the lost, you got to forgive people that hurt you, you got to serve. Of course, you got to come to church, and you got to give your money, and you got to do this, and you got to do that, and you got to do this, and you got to do that, and God loves you. And that's not a very effective way of doing anything. I mean, can you imagine if a first date until everything that would happen in that marriage. Like, okay, before I get to know you, this is what is going to happen. For the next 50 years, this is what's going to entail for you. Would you go on the date? You know, sometimes parenthood is that way. You know, a lot of times as someone that doesn't have kids, you hear about all the things that parents do. You know, and I remember growing up just seeing diapers be changed. I'm like, man, I'm never, like I was in no rush to ever have kids. You know, you see the work, the movie we went through. So we got married, and Michelle was like, oh, we gotta have kids, and I want to get advice. And I'm thinking, man, I hope, look, what? Says, you want kids too? In Jesus' time. She's trying to talk to couples about, hey, is it a good time? I'm behind them, like. It's a lot of work.
Right.
And being in love is a lot of work, right? And the truth is, it's not really effective to talk about the work before you get a hand. handle all the motivation. I tell you what, I'm in that room and Michelle delivers that baby, Jacqueline, first child, right? And the doctor gives it to me to hold. Changing diapers, what's that? Staying up late, what's that? See, once you understand the motivation, once you look into that baby's eyes and you fall madly in love, the things you do for love. I think many of us are stressing because we're thinking about what we've got to do, and either we have never fallen in love with Jesus or we've fallen out of love with Jesus. And we've got to go back to the love letter he wrote for us, because that's the way love tempts the world. You know, dog chases the cat or cat chases dog. Somebody loves somebody first. Somebody likes somebody first, right? Jesus was in love with us first. We're going to read Isaiah 52 to the end of the chapter and then pick up 53 from 1 to 5. And that's not on a fancy slide. You got to read this the old-fashioned way. Well, Bible, tablet, computer, phone, whatever you got. But you get it. Isaiah chapter 52, starting with verse 13, it says, "See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, just as there were many who were appalled at him. His appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand." Verse 1, chapter 3. Who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind. A man of suffering and familiar with him. Like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we consider him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds we have been healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Amen.
This is the love letter. I want to talk a little bit about the what, the why, and the who of the love letter. First off, what happened? Some important facts. The Bible makes the assumption that we're all lost. All of us. The on our own strength. And see, we get this messed up in our mind. You need to understand it. We feel like we deserve to go to heaven. The Bible takes us to stand for it, no matter who you are, what you've done, no matter whether you're trying to please God, not pleasing God, whether you've been a disciple, whatever you are, what you deserve in your life, and not only what you deserve back in the day, what you deserve now is you're lost. And without him, you're lost. So that's the first assumption that we have to understand. If you missed that, you can't be grateful for something if you don't understand what you are receiving. You can't be grateful for something you think you already deserve. Grace is undeserved favors. We don't deserve to be saved. Second thing is that Jesus was divine. Talked about that last week, but he was human in every way. Yes, that breaks the brain. I'm not going to go into that this week. But he felt all the things that you feel, that I feel, that you would have felt, that I would. And sometimes we diminish the impact of what happened because we in our minds, it didn't really affect him the same way because he's got son or whatever. And he felt what we feel. So that's the other thing we've got to understand going into it. That he was human. And so he suffered emotionally, physically, spiritually. I wish I had all day for this message. We don't get the cross, we never see crucifixion. If we lived 2,000 years ago, we would ride on the roadside and see people on the cross dying in agony and yelling and screaming on the cross. So the physical side of it they got. When they said that they nailed the Son of God to the cross, they had a vivid picture of what that meant. Because it'd be very difficult to live during those times and not have seen the crucifixion. We see crosses on t-shirts, bumper stickers, buildings. Jesus suffered. He suffered emotionally. I don't take my word for it. When you have time, go and look at the accounts in the Bible. If you see them before, reread them. Sometimes you got to reread them and get them fresh in your life, right?
Yes.
He felt everything that we would feel if you knew that tomorrow you were going to die. A humiliating death, a painful death, a death that would label you and your family as scum. A death that was considered too good for Romans and too good for most other people, reserved for the worst of the worst. Designed to be slow and painful, and that your family would have to watch as you died and breathe your last breath. And Jesus prayed, Father, I don't want to do this. Paraphrase. But not my will, but your will be done. He prayed so intensely his sweat fell down like drops of blood. And even his best friends fell asleep while he was going through it because they didn't understand what was going on. Betrayed by one of his best friends. All this going on. He died alone and humiliated death. People spitting on him and ridiculing him. Knowing that he had the power to come off the cross. Yes, he suffered emotionally. That's what happened. He suffered physically. He was slapped. He was spat upon. He was blindfolded. He was beaten. He was flogged. With the old whip, the cat of nine tails, bone in the middle of the end, that would make deep cuts in the back and leave your flesh hanging off. Time and time again, until the Roman soldier got tired, he was flogged. He was taken to the praetorium, he was beaten. It says in the Bible, he took a rod, took a staff, and they put a crown of thorns on his head, they cut his scalp, and put a purple robe on that back that was hanging with raw flesh. And took that rod and beat him in his head again and again. Now how badly was he beaten? I've seen the movies. You haven't seen what happened. They did a real movie. You couldn't bring your kids. You know, we just read in Isaiah 52, verse 14, it says his face was marred beyond human likeness. It means he was beaten so badly, he didn't look human. It's like taking a billy club or a nightstick and hitting Xavier in the head again and again until his face is so disfigured you couldn't forget recognizing Xavier. It didn't look like a human face. That's how badly he was beaten. Then they took the robe off his back, ripping open those wounds. And that's when they took him to be crucified. They hadn't started that. And he had to carry the top bar of the cross until he could, and they got Simon and Cyrene to do it. They took him on the hill, the Golgotha, and they nailed the nails into his wrist. And this was considered part of the hand in ancient times. Was also the place where you have nerves, central nerves running through, and you feel fire through your whole body, and they nail it to the cross, and you're hanging in misery. And we know from doctors that have studied the cross how he died and what he went through. If you go and you go to the digital version of the love story, you can there's a link there for a medical account. Read it sometime. Remind yourself of what he suffered. In agony, the back rubbing on that wood, the fire and pain going through, people ridiculing from the crowd, the thieves talking about. Someone asked me once what killed him, and I thought he bled to death, die from pain or something. Well, generally on the cross, you suffocate. Because you inhale, but you can't exhale, so you suffocate on the cross. And you go through that panicky feeling. I don't know if you have the wind knocked out of you, where you can't breathe. And in order to exhale, you have to pull yourself up by those nails and exhale to go back down all over again. So you suffocate over and over again for a period of hours or days. In this case, we know before you actually suffocated, it's heart rupture. Because when they pierced the side, water and blood came out, which is a sign of a ruptured heart. He suffered physically. He suffered spiritually. We know in Matthew 26, between 45 and 50, he cries out, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?" And it wasn't because he lost faith in God. It's because God, the Father, God, his Father, he was one from the beginning. They're one, and they're the same, and they're different. All that stuff cut him off. Like cutting off your own arm. He severed it. Because Jesus became infected with sin. It was my sin. And God can't have a relationship with sin. And as much as the emotional pain hurt, the physical pain hurt, the pain of losing the Father for me, for you, that's the what. What happened? He took our place. He took our place. Next slide, it says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." Why? We'll go back to this slide after. Next slide. It says, "God so loved the world." It states right there, why, right? It was an act of love. You know, you don't have to be very smart to know there's a God. In fact, you've got to do what I call intellectual acrobatics to not believe in God. Because the evidence of God is just look outside of your window, there's evidence of God. You don't have to look at nature very long to realize whoever made this stuff must love it. What the cross is, though, is a love letter. Written in the blood of Christ, to not just say that he loves me, that he loves you, but to show the extent of that. That I love Stephanie so much that though they beat me, I didn't make it stop. That I love Jennifer so much that told him my back was bleeding, I wouldn't make it stop. I wouldn't quit. I love Michelle so much. I love Whitney so much. I love Sean so much. The door was narrow on the cross. The whole world was against me. I was thinking about you, and I would not come down. And when you wonder, does God love me? Open up the book and read my love letter that I wrote in my own blood. If you wonder whether your life matters, whether your prayers matter, read my love letter and understand the extent of my love and how far I went to give you a chance to be with me. Just for a chance. This is like a guy that's a loveless woman and doesn't know how she responds and puts it all out there, right? Just for the chance that maybe she'd love him back. Just for the chance that one day that we may love him back. He would not come down. And that's the why. Then there's the who. Next slide. There's the who. You know, the who is the most important thing. It's the hardest part to get. Because it says God so loved the world, and one of the big reasons he had no effect on me, he did it for the whole world. And as long as that's how you feel, you missed the point. Yeah. It's a love letter into the whole world, okay? He died for the sins of the world, yeah, but every time I've lusted, every time I've sinned, every time I've lied, that was a nail on his hands. He would have to die just for my sin to be forgiven. Until this becomes personal, it has no power. And oftentimes, it's never been personal for us, or it was, and we forgot. It ceases to be personal, and it becomes religion. This was something he did for me, he did for you. And unless we understand the who, we miss it. And once you understand the who, you understand how much he loves you and what he did for you. How can you not love somebody back? See, that's the why do I love him? Why? Because he loved me first, and he loved me best.
Amen.
He loved me. And love is a motivating thing. I joke about my mom. My mom was an amazing mom, single mom. And I joke about her being disciplinarian, which she was, but she was a lot more things than that, obviously. But honestly, you know, this disciplinarian stuff, you know, trying to keep your kids in line, that's great when you're small. But she's a single mom, she had three boys and a girl, and you get to the point pretty early. Where you're as big as your mom. And you're taking harder shots playing football outside than she can get. If you're gonna be real about it. Alright, so the fear of getting a beating at 12 wasn't really the fear. It was gonna keep me in line. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Alright. And I don't forget that I was 12, maybe 13. Around, right around there, and my mom, you know, she was telling me what I needed to do, and I said something smart back to her, because I'm like, I'm a man, man. I got peach fuzz on my lip. My peach fuzz came in early. And I'm like, something smart. And she reached back, like, because, you know, black moms, if you don't know, they got, like, kung fu powers, man. They can throw a shoe like it's a throwing star from a ninja and hit you in the back of the head from a mile high. They can use a switch like a samurai sword and just chop it on them. But this was a hand slap pop. She poured, now, you know, I was pretty good hand boxing reflexes. She poured a slap out of nowhere that I never saw coming. And I just felt it. I looked and she slapped me so fast, and my lip was vibrating, and handprint all over my side of my face. And as I was trying to deal with the shock and the embarrassment of being slapped, my mom, who never cried, broke down and started weeping. Because what I had done, what I had said hurt, it hurt her so much. And I left that room and went to my bedroom and I started weeping. And I said, all the things she's done for me, I will never make her feel that way again. And so when I was going to school, people were getting into stuff and whatever, my motivation was her love. And to never let down the one that loved me. Because fear can work to a point, but love has got to kick in. It's hard being a teen in Baltimore City and doing the right thing. Only love is going to motivate you when nobody else is around. It's hard being a mom in Birmingham, in Hoover, in Shelby, in wherever you are. being a dad, being a college student, being whatever, you've got to let the love letter be your motivation. You've got to remember the love letter, the extent of the love, and decide whether you want to love them back and whether we're going to live to please the one that loves us best. I tell you what, that hurt's not worth holding on to, and that fear's not worth holding on to. You know, that guy's not worth chasing, and that woman's not worth holding on to. Whatever the situation is, that pride isn't worth holding on to. Don't hurt the one that loves you first and loves you best. My prayer this morning is that all of us reconnect for the first time, or reconnect with the love. I encourage you to go over those passages here, to read the accounts of the crucifixion, go and look for the miracle account. If you feel a disconnect between you and the Lord, go back and read the letter and let it change your life. Amen?
Yeah.
If you're interested
in learning more, becoming a member, you talk to me and Sean after church. We're right here. That's what we need to know.